Welcome to fourth part of excretory system, where we are going to study the last organ in excretory system, that is urinary bladder today. So to make it today's topic more interesting, we shall begin with a case study. A 40-year-old man was brought to emergency department after sustaining trauma to abdomen. On examination, patient appeared to be in pain and heart rate was 90 per minute, little higher. BP was around 140/80, almost normal, and respiratory rate was around 28 per minute, and hemoglobin was 10 grams per cent, and there hematuria was noted in the catheter and urobag of the patient, and free intraperitoneal fluid was found in the ultrasound and CT imaging. So what is the probable diagnosis? This is a contrast CT where intraperitoneal fluid accumulation was observed in the abdomen. So this represents the rupture of urinary bladder. The probable structure which is involved in the case is the urinary bladder. So now we understood the anatomy of urinary bladder is very important to know to understand its clinical aspect of it. So beginning with the urinary bladder, it is a muscular bag which acts like a reservoir for urine, and when it is empty it is tetrahedral in shape, and when it is filled or distended with the because of the urine present in it, it takes up the fusiform in shape. In empty urinary bladder is a tetrahedral structure having four surfaces: superior surface and inferior lateral surface, which is present on both the sides, and posterior surface, which is called as base of the urinary bladder. And there is a tip which is projecting upwards, giving attachment to a ligament called median umbilical ligament. This projection is called as the apex of the urinary bladder. And the neck is of the urinary bladder is the constricted part or fixed part of the urinary bladder, which continues below as urethra. So superior surface, two inferolateral surface, posterior surface, apex and neck. Borders of the urinary bladder, the superior surface is separated from the posterior surface by posterior border, and two inferolateral surfaces are separated by the anterior border, and the superior surface is separated from the inferolateral surfaces on the either side by lateral border. Urinary bladder, when it is empty, it is tetrahedral in shape, and it is present in the lesser pelvis. It is a true pelvic organ present in the lesser pelvis in adults. And when it is distended, when it is filled with the urine, it occupies partly abdomen, becoming abdominopelvic organ, that is in adults. In children, even when it is empty, below 6 years of age, even when it is empty, it is abdominopelvic organ. So that there are two factors which are affecting it. One is the position of the neck of the urinary bladder. In adults, if we see the position of the neck of the urinary bladder, it is located to the lower border of the pubic symphysis. That is the lower border of the pubic symphysis, the neck is located. Whereas in children below 6 years of age, after as soon as they born, newborn kids, the neck of the urinary bladder is located near the upper border of the pubic symphysis. As the age advances after 6 years to 9 years and puberty, the neck of the urinary bladder descends down to the adult position. So that is about the position of the neck of the urinary bladder. And even the bony pelvis is not that developed in children. So because it is a smaller bony pelvis, the urinary bladder, even when it is empty, it occupies partly abdomen in children. So that is about the position of the urinary bladder. Next, the capacity of the urinary bladder. The average physiological capacity is approximately around 250 to 450 ml in adults, and in newborn it is around only 20 to 40 ml in newborns. And anatomical capacity, that is when you take the urinary bladder out of the abdomen and fill it, and it can distend, it can withhold up to 1 liter or more than 1 liter of volume. So that is about the this is the sagittal section of a female and this is the sagittal section of a male pelvis. In sagittal section of the female pelvis, we can see the urinary bladder. This is the urinary bladder, which is located just behind the pubis. It is a retropubic organ present just behind the pubis. And the gap between the pubis and the urinary bladder is called as retropubic space, which is also called as space of Retzius, which is filled with the fat and venous plexus draining the urinary bladder, called as vesical plexus. And posteriorly, the urinary bladder, that is the base of the urinary bladder, is related to the vagina and the lower part of the cervix. As the females contain the uterus, and so posteriorly, urinary bladder is related to the wall of the vagina and it is related to the lower part of the cervix. And the gap between the urinary bladder and the vaginal wall, it is filled with the loose areolar tissue. Superiorly, if we see, it is overlapped by here. This is antiverted uterus, and leaving a peritoneal reflection here, urinary bladder, we can see the peritoneum gets reflected over the uterus, forming a pouch which is called as uterovesical pouch or vesico-uterine pouch. And the contents of this pouch consists of coils of the small intestine and sigmoid colon. So these are the superior relations of the urinary bladder. And let's see the relations in males, anteriorly, posteriorly and superiorly. So anteriorly, it is related to the pubis just like females, and the gap is called as retropubic space or space of Retzius, which is filled with the fat and vesical plexus of veins. And posteriorly, the base is separated from the rectum. There is no uterus and vagina here. Directly it is related to the ampulla of the rectum. And between the rectum and the urinary bladder, we can see the seminal vesicles are present, which are opening into the prostatic part of urethra. And we can see the cross ductus deferens, which is crosses the ureter and comes to lie posteriorly. So posteriorly, the urinary bladder is related to the ampulla of rectum, seminal vesicles and ductus deferens. And the peritoneal reflections, if you see, the peritoneal reflections, it reaches till the base and it gets reflected over the seminal vesicles. So the upper part of the base is related to the peritoneum. And the area where it is directly related to the seminal vesicles is called as external trigone of urinary bladder. And here is the apex of the urinary bladder, which gives attachment to median umbilical ligament, that is nothing but the urethrus, which goes and attaches to the umbilicus. And superiorly, the peritoneal reflection is between the rectum and the urinary bladder, which is called as rectovesical pouch, and the contents are coils of the small intestine and sigmoid colon are the contents. And innervated by the prostate glands in males, but whereas in females there is no such gland, here there is a prostate gland, urinary bladder. And inferiorly, anteroinferiorly, space of Retzius or retropubic space is present both in males and females. And below the retropubic space, it is formed by the wall of the pelvis, that is the anterolateral wall of the pelvis, which is formed by the levator ani muscle and obturator internus muscle. And these muscles are covered by a fascia called as the fascia of levator ani and fascia of obturator internus. So these two muscles are related anteroinferiorly, which is separated from the urinary bladder by retropubic space. More about the retropubic space. Retropubic space, it is the gap between the pubis and the urinary bladder anteriorly, and it is filled with the fat. It is a potential space for the urinary bladder to distend. But surgically, this space is very important because any surgical procedures which are done for the urinary bladder or the prostate, surgeons usually approach through this retropubic space. And boundaries of the retropubic space, anteriorly it is bounded by the pubis, and posteriorly it is bounded by the posterior true ligaments of the urinary bladder, and superiorly the peritoneal reflection, which is forming paravesical fossa, and inferiorly it is formed by the urogenital diaphragm, so muscles forming the urogenital diaphragm. So that is about the boundaries of retropubic space, and let's see this in a specimen.
This is the female pelvis. This is pubic symphysis. This is sacrum. Between them is the pelvic cavity. In the pelvic cavity in females, you find urinary bladder anteriorly, uterus in the middle, and rectum and anal canal posteriorly. Between pubic symphysis and urinary bladder is the retropubic space of Retzius. Between urinary bladder and uterus is the vesico-uterine pouch of peritoneum. Between uterus and the rectum is the recto-uterine pouch of peritoneum.
Ligaments of urinary bladder. Ligaments can be classified into two varieties, true ligaments and false ligaments. True ligaments are the ligaments which anchors the urinary bladder and supports the urinary bladder, and false ligaments are the peritoneal folds which are just present around the urinary bladder. So first we shall do with the true ligaments of urinary bladder, which are nothing but fibromuscular bands anchoring the urinary bladder. There are a pair of posterior true ligaments. Posterior true ligaments connects the posterior, that is the base of the urinary bladder, posterior surface, to the pelvic wall on the either side, goes and blends with the pelvic wall. And lateral true ligaments, lateral true ligamentary bladder to the muscles forming the pelvic wall and blends with the fascia covering the muscles, called as pelvic fascia. And anteriorly, urinary bladder is anchored by puboprostatic ligaments. In males, there is a prostate gland. So these ligaments connects the inner surface of the pubis to the prostate. So they are called as puboprostatic ligaments. And in females, they are called as pubovesical ligaments. And puboprostatic ligaments, they are again two pairs. One is medial puboprostatic ligaments and lateral puboprostatic ligaments. Medial puboprostatic ligaments are on the medial side, connecting pubis with the urinary bladder, and lateral puboprostatic ligaments connects the urinary bladder with the pelvic fascia. So these are the anchoring from down. From the apex, the urinary bladder is connected to the umbilicus by means of a ligament called as median umbilical ligament, which is also called as urachus, and it is the remnant of allantois. Urachus is the remnant of allantois, and if the allantois is persistent even after birth, the urine gets dribbled out from the umbilicus. So that is about the urachus and median umbilical ligament. Let's see about the false ligaments. The false ligament, the same median umbilical ligament is covered by a peritoneal fold which is called median umbilical fold. And on the either side of the median umbilical ligament, on the either side, there are obliterated umbilical arteries which are covered by a peritoneal folds called as medial peritoneal folds. And laterally, there are two peritoneal folds again called as lateral peritoneal folds. And posterior peritoneal folds connects the urinary bladder to the sacrum. They are called as sacrovesical folds or sacrogenital folds, which are present on the posterior side of the urinary bladder. So totally there are 7 false ligaments and 9 true ligaments. The 7 false ligaments are: one is the median umbilical fold and 2 medial umbilical folds and 2 lateral umbilical folds and 2 posteriorly, those are called as sacrogenital folds. And true ligaments are 9 in number. One is median umbilical ligament, which is the remnant of urethrus, and 2 pairs of puboprostatic ligaments, which are 4, and a pair of lateral true ligaments and a pair of posterior true ligaments. And posterior true ligaments, if we see, they contain the venous plexus which are draining the urinary bladder, called as vesical venous plexus, are enclosed within the posterior true ligaments. So that is about the ligaments of urinary bladder. Next, we shall move on to the interior of the urinary bladder. Internally, if we cut the urinary bladder and see, the most of the urinary bladder consists of mucosal foldings. And these mucosal foldings are called as rugae, which are a temporary folds. And when the urinary bladder is distended, these folds gets disappeared. And if we see the most dependent part of the urinary bladder, just near to the internal orifice, which continues down as the neck and the urethra of the urinary bladder, in that part it is makes a triangle, shining triangle like structure, called as internal trigone. The internal trigone differs from the rest of the urinary bladder because there are no rugae in the internal trigone. It is quite glistening and shining because the submucosa is absent in the internal trigone. Internal trigone, developmentally, internal trigone is from the absorbed part of mesonephric ducts, and which are from the mesoderm. The lining is from the mesoderm. And the rest of the urinary bladder, the mucosa is derived from the endoderm. If you see the internal trigone, it is like an equilateral triangle having 2 openings on the either side above. The openings are the ureteric openings, and these ureteric openings are semicircular in shape generally, and these 2 ureteric openings are connected by means of a ridge which is called as interuretric ridge, or called as Mercy's bar. And this interuretric ridge is formed by the longitudinal muscle which is present within the urinary bladder. And the apex of this trigone is below, directed below towards the internal orifice. And in males, it is having an elevation called as ovula, and which is formed by the prostate gland present underneath it. And the median lobe of the prostate gland makes an elevation called ovula in males. And in females, just it is an orifice called as internal orifice. Clinically, this internal trigone is very important because it guides the surgeons during cystoscopy. The muscle which is present within the wall of the urinary bladder is called as a detrusor muscle, and detrusor muscle is interlinked all over. So if it contracts, it contracts together. It is not like peristaltic movements. It contracts all together, causing voiding of urine from the urinary bladder. Next, we shall move on to the nerve supply of the urinary bladder. Urinary bladder is supplied by sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve supply. And sympathetic nerve supply, it is called as nerve of filling, which allows the urinary bladder to fill. And it is supplied by the spinal segments from T11, T12, L1 and L2. Means from T11 to L2, the spinal segments form sympathetic plexus, which are called as superior hypogastric plexus. Post-ganglionic fibers will form right and left hypogastric nerves, which supply the urinary bladder. So it has got inhibitory action over the detrusor muscles, which allows the detrusor muscles to relax. So it allows the filling of the urinary bladder. And at intrinsic muscles near the sphincter of the urinary bladder, it causes the contraction of the sphincter. So it closes the sphincter and allows the urinary bladder to fill. So it is called nerve of filling. The opposite action is done by parasympathetic. The parasympathetic will have a positive effect, that is, it causes the contraction of the detrusor muscles, causing the voiding of the urine or maturation. So it is called as nerve of voiding. Next, the external sphincter of the urinary bladder is made up of skeletal muscles and it is supplied by pudendal nerve. The pudendal nerve supplies the external sphincter of the urinary bladder, which is under our control. It is a voluntary control. So that is about the sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve supply. And sympathetic is called by hypogastric nerves. The parasympathetic nerve is called as nervi erigentes. So next we shall see about the blood supply of urinary bladder. Urinary bladder is supplied by superior vesical artery, inferior vesical artery and inferior gluteal arteries, branches from the inferior and obturator artery. So in males it is supplied by superior vesicle, inferior vesicle and obturator arteries, which are the branches of internal iliac artery, and branches from the inferior gluteal artery also supplies the urinary bladder. In females, the inferior vesical artery is replaced by vaginal arteries and branches of uterine arteries also supply in females. So that is the arterial supply. And venous drainage of the urinary bladder, it is drained by venous plexus, which are called as vesical plexus, which finally drain into internal iliac vein. And lymphatic drainage of urinary bladder, we can divide the lymphatics into three groups: anterior group and intermediate group and posterior group. We can divide the lymph nodes into anterior group, intermediate group and the posterior group. Infralateral surface of the urinary bladder and apex of the urinary bladder will drain into the anterior group. Superior surface will drain into the intermediate group, and posterior surface, that is the base of the urinary bladder and the neck of the urinary bladder, drains into posterior group. So that is about the lymphatic drainage of urinary bladder. Here is the specimen of excretory system showing a pair of right, this here is the right kidney, this is the left kidney. Ureters are here and below is the urinary bladder, which the urinary bladder shown from the posterior side or base of the urinary bladder, and this is the male urinary bladder, because the one is the vas deferens, one is the vas deferens which is coming in, and two are the seminal vesicles which are present on the either side, seminal vesicles, and three is the prostate, which are present on the posterior side or base of the urinary bladder, and prostate is present around the neck of the urinary bladder in males. Here the specimen shows the interior of urinary bladder. The one represents the urinary bladder interiorly showing several mucosal foldings called as rugae, and two is the internal trigone of urinary bladder. We can appreciate as a small dot, that is the opening of the ureters which are present on the either side, and the longitudinal muscular bridge between the two ureteric openings is called as interureteric ridge or Mercier's bar. Here is a better picture showing the interior of urinary bladder, showing the internal trigone of urinary bladder. The rest of the urinary bladder has got mucosal foldings, and trigone is devoid of foldings, where the submucosa is absent in the trigone, which is replaced by trigonal muscle of Bell. And we can see on the either side, superolaterally, the openings of ureteric openings. The line drawn between the two ureteric openings is Mercier's bar. This Mercier's bar guides the surgeon during cystoscope to place the catheter into the ureter. And below, the internal orifice continuing down as the urethra. And this is the male urinary bladder, because prostate gland is also present. Thank you. I hope you all like my session. Like, share, subscribe, and don't forget to press the bell button for further notifications. Bye.